This week, we look how we can apply our knowledge in practice. If we scale up from the laboratory scale to an industrial scale, we see that heat transfer becomes more difficult. One of the reasons is that the surface area for heat transfer becomes small in comparison to the volume. So the ratio of the heat exchange surface to the volume is an important parameter. Many large animals, like elephants, who lived in warm areas, do not cool down fast because the surface to volume ratio is low in comparison to the one of a small animal like a mouse. However, elephants have different ways to compensate this. For example, they have big ears to increase their surface area without increasing the volume. Take your own body. We produce heat in our body and lose it through our skin. Roughly, you can say that the ratio of the surface area of the skin and the volume of our body is the parameter which determines the speed of cooling. A baby, where the ratio is high, cools faster than an adult. That's one of the reasons that a baby who born too early have to stay in an incubator to keep their body temperature on 37 degrees Celsius. To give you a feeling, I take a sphere and a cube. The ratio of the surface area of a volume of a sphere becomes 6 over d. And for a cube, this becomes 6 over l. In both cases, the volume increases faster than the surface area, which means that it becomes more difficult to cool down or to heat up the sphere or the cube. In industry, it is quite similar. A lot of chemicals are produced in reactors where heat is produced. If heat is released during the process, it is necessary to cool down the reactor for safety reasons. Often the surface area is not sufficient to cool the process, and heat exchanging tubes are used in the reactor. Another way to heat or cool fluids is an external heat exchanger, which contains a large surface area to exchange heat. This can be tubes, plates, or more fin-like structures. You can also see them in many houses. With the knowledge learned in the previous weeks, we will design a simple heat exchanger. It gives you a feeling which parameters are relevant, but also that basic knowledge of transport phenomena can be used in practice. Consider the sketch of this basic heat exchanger. It consists of two concentric tubes, where a hot and a cold fluid flows through. Heat is exchanged from the hot to the cooling fluid by means of the wall between the two faces. A hot fluid enters the inner tube and is cooled by the cold fluid in the outer tube. The energy phi q is transferred from the hot to the cold fluid, and as a result, the fluid in the outer tubes becomes warmer along the length of the tube. If we know three temperatures, for example, the inlet of the hot and the cold fluid, and the outlet temperature of the cooling fluid, we can calculate the outlet temperature of the hot fluid. How can we obtain the outlet temperature of the hot fluid? Any idea? Think about the thermal energy balance discussed earlier. Under steady state conditions, we can say that the amount of energy, phi q, is transferred from the hot to the cold fluid. Further, we assume that the temperature increase as a result of energy dissipation is small. The thermal balances of the cold and the hot flow under steady state conditions become now the following. If the mass flow rates and the heat capacities are known, we can obtain phi q from the thermal energy balance of the cold stream, and using this value of the phi q in the thermal balance of the hot fluid, we obtain the outlet temperature of the hot fluid. Okay, we know all the temperatures, but to design a basic heat exchanger, we want to answer questions like, what is the length of the heat exchanger? To answer this question, we need to know how large the surface area is over which heat is exchanged between the hot and the cold fluid. In this example, we know the inlet temperatures and the outlet temperatures of the involved fluid, and as a result, we know how much energy is transferred from the hot fluid to the cold fluid. The total heat transferred from one side to the other side can be expressed by the amount of energy exchanged between the two fluids. So the amount of the energy phi q is the product of the overall heat transfer coefficient u, the surface area A, and the so-called logarithmic temperature difference delta TLN. The overall heat transfer coefficient u covers the process from the hot to the cold liquid, including the conduction through the wall. Its reciprocal value represents the sum of all the resistances involved in the heat transfer process. This means that it is the sum of the heat resistances at the side of the hot fluid, the conduction through the wall, and the resistance at the side of the cold fluid. In practice, it is often difficult to determine all the resistances separately. For this reason, the value of the overall heat transfer coefficient is often used. The surface area A is the total surface over which energy is exchanged. For a tube, this is the product of the perimeter and the length. The delta TLN is a logarithmic average temperature difference between the hot and the cold fluid, which contains the differences between the inlet temperatures and the outlet temperatures of the fluids. Theory shows that along the tube the temperature difference changes, and it can be derived that the logarithmic temperature difference describes this process well. Here we will not go into the derivation of delta TLN. Delta in represents the temperature difference between the hot and the cold fluid, and the inlet and the delta out represents the temperature difference between the hot and the cold fluid at the outlet. Summarizing, we can say that with the thermal energy balances and an equation which describes the heat transfer process between the hot and the cold fluid, we are able to obtain the surface area and the length of the heat exchanger. As illustrated, there are two ways of operating such a heat exchanger. The fluids can flow co-currently or counter-currently. The question is, what's the most effective way of exchanging heat co-currently or counter-currently? To illustrate this, we take an example of heating up a vegetable oil stream from 10 to 50 degrees Celsius with a water stream of 70 degrees Celsius. The diameter of the tube is 2.5 cm, and the overall heat transfer coefficient is 1200 watts per meter per Kelvin. The mass flow rate of the oil and water are 0.1 kg per second and 0.2 kg per second respectively, while the heat capacities are 1700 and 4200 joules per kilogram per Kelvin. From the energy balance, we can calculate the outlet temperature of the water, which becomes 61.9 degrees Celsius. Subsequently, we can calculate the logarithmic temperature difference for both situations. For co-current flow, delta TLN becomes 29.7 degrees Celsius, and for counter-current flow, 33.4 degrees Celsius. The temperature difference immediately shows that countercurrent is more effective than co-current. Finally, it shows that we need 2.43 meters to heat up the oil co-currently and 2.60 meters for countercurrently flow. This is an example for one tube, but it illustrates how you can design the size of a heat exchanger with the knowledge you learned in the last weeks. Good luck with the exercises, and thank you for your attention.